Well, it is just great to hear from you. I didn't learn until recently that you went to the University of Illinois, and here in Missouri, we'll try not to hold that against you.
Okay, wait just a minute. You may have to talk a little more. I'm going to put you on this. Hello?
Yeah, hey.
Yeah,
how is that, Sam?
Yeah, I think I almost got you right. Okay, keep talking.
Okay, we will, and if you ever, you know, need us to repeat anything, just let us know.
Okay, don't speak too quickly because, you know, it takes me a while to process things now.
Well, understandable, of course, Sam.
Yeah. Why?
All right, Sam, the Andy Griffith Show. What was it like working with...
It was great. It was one of my favorite jobs that I've ever had. Everybody, you know, however they came off on the show, that's the way they were. Just wonderful people. A lot of fun. And it was one of my first jobs out here. Actually, it was my first situation comedy that I wrote.
Well, you mentioned how wonderful it was, you know, working with that cast. How much interaction did you have with the cast, with Don Knotts, of course, with Andy? How much interaction did you have with them? Obviously, you wrote several episodes.
Yeah. Well, you know what? We used to, what we did was we really wrote at home, and we went down to the set very, very seldom, you know. But I got, you know, I knew Andy well, and Don, I got to know very, very well. I actually, what did I do? Did I direct? I directed him in a play that we did up in Traverse City, Michigan. Don, and we became very, very good friends. And he's done a number of plays in Kansas City at the New Theater. You know, I think one of them was mine. I don't remember. I think it was Norman. Is that you? I don't remember, but Don Knotts was just a wonderful guy. I mean, just, you couldn't find a nicer person. Well, maybe you could, but, you know, that book. No, he was great. I loved him.
Well,
I'll tell you something interesting about Don. He was married 3 times, and at his funeral, all 3 wives showed up. I mean, it's hard to dislike him. You know, he just was such a terrific person and a wonderful actor. Just wonderful. People probably don't realize how wonderful he was, but he was just great. I mean, they know he was funny, but he also was a good actor. Yeah.
Well, you also said that a couple more people that were some of your favorites to work with were Jim Nabors and Tim Conway.
Jim was a very nice guy. You know, I didn't get to know him too well, but he was a very, very nice guy. And, Tim was the best. He was great. He's not doing well now, medically. You know, he has some severe problems. But there was no one funnier than Tim Conway. Tim could actually fall up a flight of stairs. So I just loved Tim. He was just one of the great, great comics of all time. Every time I see him on Carol Burnett, if I'm in a rerun, I mean, I know I'm going to laugh.
Well, Sam, in 1990, you quit doing television to focus more on plays, and you said it was a great decision. Why did you do that, and why was it a good decision?
Why was it a good decision? Well, television changed. When I started writing in the 60s, about 90% of what you wrote got on the air. You know, it was, you know, really writing. And now it's changed. It's kind of a group effort, most television shows. So if you wrote a script, then the staff gets together and they tear it apart. There's very little, especially if you're not on that staff. There's very little that's left. And I just didn't want to do that anymore. You know, it was what I liked about, well, I didn't really get into it too much, but on television there's more freedom than there ever used to be. when we were, I wrote, it was very kind of restricted. I mean, my God, you know, it was the days when Lucy and Kenzie couldn't sleep together, you know. And, but it went through a transition where I just didn't enjoy working on it anymore. And I had 25 years of it, and I just thought, I think I was in my 60s. I said, you know, I don't know how long I'm going to be around, but I want to do what I want to do now. I mean, and I fortunately had enough money to do it. And I just kind of quit and just started writing plays and being at home and hanging around with my dogs. And it was great. It was great. I don't regret it. I don't regret it one bit. But I do wish that when I was writing, we had the freedom that people have now on television. I mean, God, I'm in shock sometimes with all the things I saw. And, you know, when I did the Smothers Brothers show, that was considered, you know, really radical. And now it's just mild entertainment. You know, it's just not what it used to be in the 70s when I did it.
Well, we've got some conflicting reports on the pilot for Saved by the Bell. We heard that it was what you wrote was kind of a world outside of Saved by the Bell that was turned into by Peter Engel and Brandon Tartikoff into Saved by the Bell, yet you still get the created by credit. What went into that?
Yeah. Well, I think at the beginning of the show, it was supposed to be for high school kids. And I actually wrote up some, like 50 ideas for, you know, the show. And then when we went in to pitch it to Tartikoff, Brandon, he wanted to do it about his third grade teacher. And so, his fourth grade teacher. So we just did it that way. We just did the high school. But it was the start of, you know, Saved by the Bell actually was supposed to be about teenagers. And Brandon changed it. And then it went back. They kept the principal, I guess. And I don't know why I got the credit. It was good. I guess because I started it. The Writers Guild is very very protective of the writers, you know. And that's what happened, you know. I had produced the first show. It was called Armist Bliss. Haley Mills, who was just wonderful. And then the show didn't get on that season. And so I got another job. I took it to another job. I signed with Rand Tinker's company for a couple years. And when that show went on the air, I didn't want to go. I just didn't feel like I wanted to go back to it, you know. And actually, contractually, I could not go back to it for a couple of years. So that's what happened. It's a complicated kind of thing. But I will say this, Peter Engel really was the voice of the show.
Yeah, we've spoken with Peter in the past and also with Bennett Tramer, who did a lot of writing for the show. Do you think that there's any resentment on their part?
Can you say that again? What?
Do you believe that there's any resentment on the part of Peter Engel or anyone else involved that that like you're credited with creating the show?
I don't think he had a choice. I mean, we were good friends, Peter and I. I didn't see any problem. I don't. I didn't stay with this show, you know. I just did the one pilot.
Right.
And that's how I got the created by. But I no longer got the produced by because I wasn't producing it. I just produced the first Armist Bliss show, which turned into Saved by the Bell. So, you know, that's just the way. Well, I was very lucky. Sometimes you're lucky, sometimes you're not, you know. But I was lucky. I got the credit, you know. I don't know what good it did me, but because I was already doing very nice things, you know. So it's just the way it was. I hardly watched the show at all, you know. It was for teenagers, for kids, for young kids. But amazing how long it ran. I actually made Peter very, very rich. So he should be very, very happy.
Absolutely, Sam. And you've been a playwright. You wrote for TV, but you were also a songwriter. Your first hit, The Girl of My Best Friend, ended up being recorded by Elvis Presley. Talk about just what an experience that was for you.
It was a surprise experience. I had no idea he recorded it, you know. And it was great. I still get checks from it, you know. God, how long ago was that written? I think I was in my 20s. Now I'm in my 80s. So it's kind of 60 years later, and it's still bringing in money because of Elvis. But that also was lucky. So much success is based on luck. I got to tell you the truth. I know a lot of wonderful writers that really just never made it this town. And I know a lot of writers who are just so-so who are doing very, very well. It's a business, so you got to be lucky. If you're lucky, and then if you're talented, you're going to do very well in this town.
Sam, talk about some of your favorite plays that you've writ, whether it's The Psychic, Fleming, that you won awards for, or maybe Norman, is that you?
Yeah, well, you know what? Talking about my favorite plays is like talking about children, which is my favorite child. You know, you can't make that choice. But I did, like, I love the Psychic was really terrific. Norman is at You was the first play I wrote. I wrote it with Ron Clark, and, you know, I was just a novice then. But it was fun. I enjoyed every play I wrote. I liked it. Some, you know, did very well. Some did not do very well. But you love them all, you know. It just, you spend a year writing them, or, you know, close to a year. So you really live with it for a long, long time. It's not like TV. TV, a half hour, I used to knock it out in, you know, a week or 2 weeks, you know, each show. Because there was, you only needed 26 minutes. I forgot what it was of show. But with a play, you need, you know, 2 hours. And the constructing it is much different than constructing a television show.
Well, Sam, you've accomplished so much in your career. And, you know, as you look back now, are there some moments or things that stood out, or things that make you, you know, realize when you were a younger person, you know, that you had that creative side to get into the entertainment business? When did that kind of happen for you, that you knew you had this creative side to you, that you could be in entertainment?
Yeah, I kind of backed into writing by mistake, you know. I loved writing because when I was in the service, I wrote, you know. But I didn't have any intention of becoming a television writer because I lived in the Midwest, and that looked like, at that time, it looked like an impossible thing to do, you know. I mean, you would look at movie stars and say how lucky they are and how, where do they come from and all that, you know. So most writers out here seem to have come from someplace else. And so it's just a matter of either wanting to do it, really, you know, and coming out here to try to do it, or just being lucky, like I think I was. I really, when I graduated college, even though I had a degree in journalism, I really had no idea what I was going to do, what I wanted to do. I mean, and I had an aunt who lived in New York, and she says, "Come to New York." So I went to New York. I had been to New York before because I was stationed when I was in the service. I was stationed at Camp Kilmer, and I used to go into New York all the time. I used to see the plays all the time. And that was something I thought I could never do either. And what happened was I didn't know what I wanted to do. And instead of looking for a job, I would go out and watch baseball games in Central Park. My my aunt was the one who pushed me. I was living with her, and she had a friend who worked at ABC and got me a job in the mailroom. And, you know, it was a little bit degrading because I was, like, I think 22 or 23, you know, to start in the mailroom, and I felt, you know, like, this is terrible. But what happened was I heard of another job as an office boy on a show called Washington Square. I don't know if you remember Ray Bolger. He was a famous dancer. He was the Scarecrow in The Wizard of Oz.
Oh, wow, and, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. You remember him, right? So what happened was I applied for the job as an office boy, and for some reason I got that job. And because I really wasn't qualified to be an office boy, I thought the mailroom was as far as I was going to go. But I was hired by an assistant, an agent's assistant by the name of George Shapiro. He hired me. We are still friends to this day. George ended up producing the Seinfeld show. And, you know, he's, and we're still very, very good friends. But he hired me. And I would try to write sketches for the show. The show was dreadful. But I said, you know, I like writing. Let me try to write some sketches. And I started writing there. And George loved the sketches. They never got on the show. But he got me some other jobs as an office boy or whatever it is. And in New York, I don't know how it happened. I started getting a few jobs on game shows and writing interviews for people. I'll tell you about that later. But I kind of worked my way up. I started, I was an office boy on a show called Make Me Laugh. I think they only did 13. And Robert G. Lewis was the host at that time. People won't remember him, but he was fairly well known. And they had a party when the show ended. And for some reason, I was sitting at Robert G. Lewis's table, and I was very funny. And I don't know, you know, it's just one of those things. He was writing a radio. He was actually working, or he had. He had a radio show. It was actually the last network radio shows on the air. And because I was funny, he said, why don't you come and write for me, which I did. And that's kind of how I drifted into writing. I got other jobs from that job. And, you know, once you get your foot in the door, and it was a much smaller business, yeah, people know you. And I think my last job in New York was before I went out to California was Captain Kangaroo. I wrote that show for a while, which it was nice. And but after 6 months, I think I got very tired of it because people were too nice to me. It was one of those jobs where you could just stay there the rest of your life, or how long the show would go on. And it got a little tiresome, and I just wanted to go on. And so I left that show. And during that time, I had written The Girl, My Best Friend. It took me about, Beverly Ross, I think it took less than 2 hours to write the song. And Elvis recorded it. I said, this is a lot better than writing. I mean, it only took 2 hours. But I never had a hit again after that. And so my friend George Shapiro said, come out to California. I'll get you work, which he did. And little by little, I started getting jobs, and there I was. How I got into playwriting, really, is after the Smothers Brothers, we went to do a show called the Kraft Music Hall. And there'd be a new host on there every week, Alan King, I don't know, all the old stars would host it once a week. And we would write sketches. And it was really kind of easy. And so, it was a summer show we came out to do there with, who were the hosts? One was Eddie Arnold, and one was Ed McMahon. I don't know if you were going to remember these guys. Eddie Arnold was a country music star who was kind of hot at the time. And Ed McMahon was the host, was the announcer for
Johnny Carson.
Johnny Carson, yeah. And the shows literally would take us a day to write. They were so easy because they were filled with music and, you know, a little dialogue and, you know, once in a while a sketch. So while we were in New York, my partner Ron Clark and I, we said, we're here, let's write a play. And that's how we wrote our first play, Norman Is That You. Norman Is That You, it was one of the funniest shows that I think Broadway ever saw. But it was a show about a father who comes to town, to New York, and finds out his son is gay and how he adjusts to it. And it was very, very funny, but New York wasn't ready to make fun of, you know, to make a comedy about homosexuality. And also, we were television writers who were very little respect, we had very little respect in the New York theater. And so the critics were very, very tough on us, and the show closed in about 2 weeks, you know. And the reviews, while some of the reviews were great, the main ones in the newspaper and the New York Times and stuff, they were just awful, you know. And the next day, I picked up a Post to read a review, and on the front page was a story about a guy who committed a terrible, terrible murder in New York. He killed a woman and threw her down the elevator shaft. And I realized when I read my review and I read the story about the this murderer, I realized, hey, they were nicer to the murderer than they were to us. And so I knew there was going to be trouble in, you know, being a playwright. But Ron and I loved doing it so much that we continued to do it, and New York continued to kill us. I think we had four plays in New York, and each one, they just hated it. They hated comedy, New York. I mean, they hated, I think, California comedy or situation comedy. I once went was interviewed by a reporter who was a critic in fact, it was in Kansas City. I think it was on the Star. Is that your newspaper?
Yeah.
In Kansas City.
Yep.
Yeah. He was interviewing me about a play. We were doing a new play called Remember Me at the New Theater. And he read it, and you know, before he interviewed me. And I said, did you read the play? He said, yes, I did. And I said, well, did you think of it? He said, well, it's a situation comedy. I said, can you tell me of any comedy on Broadway that wasn't a situation comedy? And he said, well, you got me there. So it was just that at that time, television writers just weren't accepted in New York. And now they are. Now you need television stars to pull people in. So it's a different business. But I did not want to go through that whole process, New York, finding a producer. So when I started writing on my own, what I would do is just have the plays published and let them go out on their own and do what they do. And I didn't have to get involved too much with finding a producer and waiting to be produced. And you know, it takes forever on Broadway. That's the story of, you know, my playwriting, why I liked it so much. I also was very lucky there, too. I was supposed to go back to New York with a serious play. And I think, who was the guy? Kermit Bloomgarten, who was a famous producer at the time, was going to produce it off-Broadway. And I didn't take any jobs for that season because I was expecting to go to New York. Well, he died, and I never had to play. You know, there was no way anybody else was going to take the play that season. So I was doing nothing, and I got a call from someone from 20th Century to go out to Dr. The Wiz. It was the Broadway play, and it was not doing well. It was running. It was like 3 hours. It was running out of town. The play took 3 hours, and I went to see it. They sent me to Detroit, and I saw this little girl come out. She wasn't very pretty, and I said, God, why did they have her be Dorothy, you know? And at the end of the show, her name was Stephanie Mills. At the end of the show, you loved her so much. She was so fantastic. But the show was much too long. And so what I did was we were going to Philadelphia, and 1 week I started just cutting the heck out of it and rewriting scenes and just slicking it down, and I brought it in under 2 hours, and it went to New York. It had an advance of $12,000. No one was interested in it, and it looked like I got involved with another failure. But fortunately, 20th Century could not close the play because they did not want to report the loss. It was $1 million the play cost, which is nothing that by today's standards, but they didn't want to report $1 million loss, and they were having a board meeting. So they kept the play open and for four more weeks. And in those 4 weeks, it caught fire. The people started seeing it, and word of mouth was really very, very good. And it became a hit, and it still goes around making money. So I was very fortunate for that. That also helped me give up television, you know, because I still get royalties from it. That's pretty much fun. Am I talking too much?
No, absolutely not, Sam. We can't thank you enough for joining us today. But before we let you go, we've got our 3-hour review of the Game of Thrones. We want you to join us for it. Are you in?
Okay, well, say that again and say it slower. You got what?
Before we let you go, Sam, we have our 3-hour review of the Game of Thrones, and we know you're such a fan. We want you in on it.
You want me to help you review Game of Thrones?
Yeah.
Just
you want to know something? I didn't see it. I never got into it, and the reason was because it was a show that it would be continued the next week. You know, it was just it was a serial, and at my age, I didn't want to. You know, I was in my 80s. I said I could die any minute. Why would I want to watch a show that I'm not going to see the end of? So I never watched the Game of Thrones, but I'm watching now a great, great show called Barry. I don't know if you've seen it on HBO. Is it HBO? I'm not sure. It's HBO Showtime. It's HBO, and that's a fun show to watch.
I haven't seen that. We haven't seen Game of Thrones either, Sam. We had emailed you that earlier, and we had talked a little bit on email about how neither one of us had seen Game of Thrones. So we were only kidding. But Sam, I tell you what a career. We just can't thank you enough for joining us here and to talk about it. And it's just been such a pleasure. We can't thank you enough, and we hope we can stay in touch, and we'll have to talk soon, my friend.
Okay, I'm going to go now and try to. I got depressed from this phone call when I realized how long a career I had and how old I am. So now I'm going to go and try, and maybe I'll get a cheeseburger someplace and a milkshake, and I'll be back. I won't be so depressed. But I really did have a long career, and I got to say, for the most part, I would say it was great fun. It was really great fun. So I really enjoyed it. I was very fortunate.
Thank you so much, Sam. It was an honor.